Hey guys, in this video I will be talking about how my mosaic add-on functions and how to actually use it. If you would like to skip the first part, please move to this part of the video. Hello, I'm Haruka, aka V14 from the University of Tokyo Lego Club. We're a small club, we aren't registered with the university, nor are we associated with the Lego group in any way. Now, onto why did I need to create another mosaic software? There are dozens of them out there in the world already, some good, some decent. And there's the official one at lego.com, which isn't too impressive. And another one that comes with Studio from Bricklink. There are some other ones that stand out, including Brick Art by Ryan Temple, Lego Art Remix by Dev Banarj, and the Lego Art Mosaic Generator by Joachim Gassen. The first reason why I wanted to create my own software is that I wanted an in-house solution that could serve our specific needs. If a new color becomes available in the future, we need to be able to add it. Also, some of the mosaic generators I mentioned before are restricted to a Lego art dimension of 48 by 48 studs. Maybe I could have just forked it, but that's not fun. The other reason is that it needs to be serviced by our new members, who aren't guaranteed to have programming experience. We used to rely on a generator created by our former member, Halfbot, but we didn't understand how it worked. I read its source code for about a year and came to understand next to nothing about it, especially the filter algorithm. I wanted to avoid this program becoming a black box as well in a few years, so I am making this video to accompany it. And that means saying goodbye to all the fancy linear programming and machine learning stuff because I'm too stupid and don't have the time to learn any of those. Okay, let's just jump right in. But before we get to actually making any mosaic, how do colors work? If you know anything about computer monitors, you know that color is represented in three values, red, green, and blue. Human retina typically has four types of photoreceptor cells, three of which react primarily to three different wavelengths. This is what enables us to see color, specifically the combination of the responses of each type of photoreceptor cell. If this one responds, then you're seeing red, and if these respond, then you're seeing cyan. Your computer monitors and smartphone screens take advantage of this by having tiny dots that light up in red, green, and blue. That's good and all, but calculating solely with RGB values is bad. Because the RGB values and the human perceptions aren't matched one-to-one, you need to account for it by gamma correction. This is the gradient without gamma correction, and this is the linear gradient with gamma correction. Then you have color spaces. The gamma corrected RGB space is 1, and it's useful for mixing colors. I use it for scaling images and other stuff. There is also another one. As it turns out, humans see in RGB, but they don't feel it in RGB. They think in some other axis defined in their brains. There is a whole field of study that determines how color is best arranged, and I'm using the latest one I can find called CAM16. I'm actually using the CAM16 uniform color space to calculate the similarity and or the difference between colors. It looks nice, doesn't it? Now I can start talking about image manipulation. With the power of the RGB color space, I can downscale an image by sampling and averaging each pixel. And with the RGB values of every LEGO color, I can posterize it. Posterizing is very easy. You take each pixel and ask which LEGO color is the closest to it. This results in a very inaccurate image, especially if you are using the wrong colors. The resulting image is also very flat, as in having little noise locally, unless you're at the threshold. This works particularly well in an already flat image, such as stylized illustrations. I should probably investigate algorithms that can reduce the jaggedness of the borders, but that's for another time. Then we have dithering. Dithering makes the resulting image very messy locally, but accurate in color broadly. It's a trade-off between resolution and color accuracy. The most famous algorithm is the Floyd Steinberg, which takes the posterization error of each pixel and compensates for it in the neighboring pixels according to this distribution. This fits our needs very well, as we often build large mosaics that use several base plates, but this is not enough. For example, what if we didn't have the right colors to emulate the original color? The error might accumulate over large areas and could mess up our algorithm. So what I did was to constrict the colors of the original image so that it only included a color that was reproducible. To do this, you take each color of the palette as vertices and create a convex hull within the color space. Then you take the original image and snap all the colors that don't fit inside of the hull onto its surface. This leaks some of the information that the original image had, which I'm not very happy about, but I'm too tired to come up with better methods. Now every color in the image should be able to be represented by a mixture of no more than 4 colors, since every coordinate within the hull should be inside of a tetrahedron. Okay, this looks promising enough, but there is one more step in my opinion for it to be a truly LEGO mosaic. Floyd Steinberg design is known to create neat checkerboard patterns at the 50% threshold, but the image usually has fine gradients which can result in messier patterns. If this was a single dimension grayscale image, then there is an elegant method called order dithering, but for full color there seems to be no better way to do it than applying it individually for R, G, and B values. What I did instead was apply a 2x2 RGB pattern over the color corrected image. This should create a bit more orderly, predictable mosaic that is easier to build and to look at. And this can make the image resolution even worse than it is, but not by a lot since the dithering process already messes it up. I also built in an edge detection filter so that I can apply less noise on the edges to hopefully preserve some of the features. After all that, the dithering algorithm is applied and voila, the mosaic is finished. Now onto the part where we actually use this add-on. To use this, you first need to install it to your Google Sheets. Find the add-on from the Get Add-ons menu, and give it the permission to access your spreadsheet and Drive. After installment, you still need to enable it for it to be active on your spreadsheet. Find Mosaic Maker from the Extensions menu and enable it. After that, you can see all the functions. Alternatively, you could press View Document Add-ons to have a better access to the menu. First thing to do is to add a palette. Since I'm turning an image into a LEGO mosaic, I'm going to select the LEGO palette. You can edit and add colors however you want, you can even have multiple palettes, but they need to have palettes somewhere in their name, and only one has to be selected. Selecting is done by the top left checkmark. Importing a picture is done through a URL. The image needs to be something like a JPEG, PNG, or a bitmap. If it has transparency or is ridiculously big, then you can throw errors. I'm sorry if you wanted to use a local image, I need to improve my UI, but for now, you need to upload it to your Drive and get the link for it. Then you can use your local image. If the image is more than 128 pixels wide, you'll be asked to resize it. You could type something like 128xn to set its height automatically. 2n also works if you want it to be an even number. After you've selected which colors to use, posterization is done with a single click. If you want, you can change the colors and do it again, or revert it back to the original. Dithering is also done in the same manner. You can count the number of times each color appears from here, and you can see which colors are used very little or aren't used at all. You can adjust the colors based on this information, and if you are extremely lazy though, you can do this instead. First, select every color available in the palette and posterize. Then press here, which will deselect every color that wasn't used. After that, you can dither. Saving is done to your Google Drive. It will be saved with the sheet's name, so you might want to change it before you actually press save. It will be saved with x5 magnification as default, and you can change it from the extended menu. If you want to export the mosaic into Bricklink Studio, it's best to save the image in its original size. Open the extended menu and set the magnification to x1. Save it to Drive, then download it, and open the mosaic tool in Studio. Set the size to that of the image, set the color setting to original, and convert. You might need to correct some colors, as Studio can make mistakes. If you have reached this part of the video, thank you for watching to the end. I hope you find a use for this, with LEGO bricks or with something else entirely. I need feedback, so if there is a bug or a suggestion, be sure to comment down below. Okay, bye.